good to have everyone out tonight, and those of you that will, join us in the choir. We're going to sing out of the Blue Mull Book. Need all your help. Men, come on.
Far away, oh, they tell me of a home where the Yeah.
Anybody have a song on your heart tonight? No, Brother Kill.
Amen. It's good to be back in God's house tonight. Good to see each one that's come out to be with us. Before we go any farther, we've got a couple, at least two, I know, that want to be anointed with oil and prayed for. And I'll ask them to come up just in a few minutes. But is anybody, I'm going to go ahead and update you on Jimmy Wheeler. He's still in the hospital. Talked to Diane this afternoon, and he possibly get to come home tomorrow. He's doing a little bit better, but they really need our prayers. And so just pray that, I know it would help them out and give them a little bit of relief if he could come home, I believe. But remember Jim and Diane tonight. And I know we need to pray for Bob and Betty. Keep them in our prayers. And has anybody else got other special requests that you want made mention of tonight here while we gather and pray? Marcy? Feller that RC works with, his sister, the guy's sister-in-law, is battling cancer and maybe near the end, it appears. So remember her and that family. Let's pray for Swanee tonight. Yes, remember her. Vera Dodgins, need to remember her. She's had, we've called in hospice and need to remember her and her family. Remember that tonight. Any other special requests? Renata's got a special unspoken request. Anybody? Anybody else? Ashley's boss's mother needs our prayers. Got some very serious medical issues. Anybody? Bobby Donaldson, and especially for his family. Ricky Coley. Anybody else? Well, let's remember all these. At this time, I'm going to ask Jane if she'll come up. She's going to stand in for her son, Wesley. And Miss Claudine Simmons wants to be anointed. She's got some health issues and wants to be anointed. Everybody can and will, let's come gather around these. If you need prayer or want to stand in for somebody, well, we'll do that as well. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I anoint you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we just come to you tonight. Lord, we are thankful for your blessings and goodness. Lord, tonight we ask you to forgive us of anything that might be a hindrance to this service here tonight or these prayers being answered. Lord, we just want to lift up these, Lord, that are standing in and for those that's here for prayer tonight, Lord, we just ask, Lord, that you'd hear and answer these prayers. We do pray for Wesley. Lord, as he has another surgery, we pray you bless and meet the needs there for him. Just Jane and her whole family, bless and meet the needs there. Lord, we pray for Claudine. Lord, we just pray you just touch her body and meet the needs there, Lord, as only you can. Lord, and we thank you and praise you that you will hear and answer our prayers and you're able. Lord, to bless and meet our needs. And Lord, we ask tonight, Lord, that you just bless and meet these needs, and not only these, Lord, but all these other spoken requests that have been mentioned, and unspoken requests as well, Lord. A lot of needs around us, and many that are sick around us, and different things are going on. Lord, we lift these up to you, Lord. We just thank you for allowing us to be able to be in your house tonight. We just pray you'd bless the rest of this service. Bless this word, that it'd be a help to every one of us to draw closer to you. Lord, we just thank you and praise you, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Bless you.
Thank you. Amen. If you got your Bible, go and turn with me over to the Gospel of John, the first chapter, and then also Little John, if you will, First John. So the Gospel of John and then First John, and both of those will be in the first chapter of each one. And I'm going to try to share, seems like what God's put on our heart, share a few thoughts with you here tonight, and mostly going to be talking about the light that shined our way from God, and he is the light, as I'll read here just in a little bit. As I thought about it, I've mentioned this, I just really, really love the Gospel of John. It's probably my favorite. It's very different from the other Gospels, and seems like if I could title the Gospel of John, it would tell us how to get saved, to believe and be saved. And then, as I thought about it and studied this, if we title the first epistle of John, or First John over here, it would be how to live and have joy and be blessed in your life living for God. And both of those involve the light, if you will, here tonight. We'll read as being saved, that involves God shining his light and showing us our condition, and then getting saved. And then staying joyful and living for God and at peace with God involves God shining his light and showing us things that we need to lay aside, or things where areas where we need to put God first, or things that don't need to be there. It all involves God shining his light. If I could, though, I wanted to read one thing over here at the end of the Gospel of John. As I said there just a little bit ago, the Gospel of John's different from the others. And it just tells you right here just exactly what it's all about. Gospel of John, chapter 20, verse 30. He says, "And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book." This is nearly at the end of the gospel right there. He said, there's a lot of things that Jesus did that's not written in this book. He said, "But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name." The Gospel of John is written so people can find out about Jesus and be saved. That's what it's written about and what it's written for. I didn't say that. His word says that. But then as we jump over into the First John, it's being saved, knowing that you're saved, but also living with the joy that only God can give us and the peace of God in our heart, which is walking in God's will. I want to read over here, though, first in the beginning, over here in the beginning of the Gospel of John. And again, we're going to talk about the light and allowing here tonight. If you're not ever been saved, you need to allow God's light to shine on your heart and show you how you stand, and that's lost and undone without hope. And then allow God's light to shine in there and show you that he loves you. And he wants to save you and wants to bless you and do you good. You need to do that. But if you're here tonight and you have been saved, we need to allow God's light to shine in there and show us areas where we can draw closer to him, show us areas where we can do better, show us guidance and direction. But it all starts with God shining his light. I just ever since I got studying about this and thinking about this, I got thinking about a song that Nawana used to sing, and I believe it was, I'm trying to think of the name of it, but it talks about our heart and how our heart is like a house, okay? And there's all different rooms in a house. And a lot of times, if we ain't careful, we'll close off rooms to God and things, areas where we might even hide things from our own self, but there'll be stuff in there that we kind of close off to God. Well, as I thought about that, and then it talks about how the person in the song just went ahead and God opened it up, and then they felt better after they turned it all over to God. But I thought, we ain't hiding nothing from God, really. I mean, God knows it all. We may think we're hiding stuff from God, but it ain't doing us but nothing but bad. I thought about this, I remember maybe years ago when we was little, and at Christmas time, they'd have in the Sears and Roebuck catalog, most of these kids don't know that about the Sears and Roebuck catalog, but they'd have like doll houses or play houses or stuff like that, and I thought, boy, one of them would be neat, and you could put them people in there, but you pull the lid off of it, and you can see right down in there and what's going on in every room of that house or that little playhouse with the figures and things in it. I thought, our life's about that away. Our heart's about that away, you know. They ain't nothing hid. God sees right down into the top of everything. So we're not hiding anything from God. And what he's going to talk about over here in 1 John in a little bit is that light. We need to let that light shine in there because we're not hiding anything. And we do have areas of darkness. And what do you say, talking about areas of darkness? It can be hidden sin, something that nobody else knows about, but we know about. It can be pride, arrogance, dishonesty, things like that. Could be envy, could be things like that. Could be unforgiveness, a spirit of unforgiveness or a grudge, all them kind of things that nobody else sees, but they're hid in there. We need to let God's light shine in there and show us those things and then turn from those things. But anyhow, God is light. Over here, turn with me, if you will, Gospel of John, chapter 1. And I just love this part down through here. Why are you reading that? Because it talks about the light. Jesus is the light. And he's the Word. He's the living Word of God right here. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. I've thought about that a lot of times. We're studying one of the Gospels back there in the Sunday school class, and Gospel of Matthew, and it starts there where Jesus is born. But that ain't when he begins. He didn't have a beginning. He was all the way back yonder at the beginning. He was with God. He's the Word. He was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And when you hear and read in the Gospel of John about the Word, that's Jesus. He is the Word. But he goes on. He's not just the Word. He's the light. As he goes on down through here, verse number 3, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. You know, that's different from the other Gospels, is it don't start about how Jesus was born and came to this earth. It just said he was the Word. He was in the beginning. He made everything. He created it all. It was God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They was all together there. And he goes on, and it says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light. You remember that tonight if you don't remember anything else. Jesus is, God is, he's the light. He shows us how we stand. As I said there earlier, we're lost and undone and without hope. We had broken fellowship when sin come in, but he's the light to shine and guide every person into a right relationship with God. He's the light. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. The light came and shined into the world, and what's happening in the world today, still the majority is not comprehending the light. Far as that goes, I'm afraid the majority don't want to see the light, okay? Don't want to have the light shined in to what's going on into their life. But God is light, and he shines into the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. He even goes on, he says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. You know, John the Baptist, what he's talking about right there. He said, there's one comes after me that shoe latchet's not even worthy for me to unloosen. He was talking about Jesus. He came to bear the witness of the light, and that light was Jesus. He was not that light. John was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. This is all talking about Jesus, the Word, the light. He came, and his own received him not. And talking about the Jewish people there, they received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Why did he come? So that those that believe on him could become sons of God. And I'm thankful for that tonight. But he goes on, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. When we believe, when we trust on Jesus, we're born of God. And he goes on and he says, how did it all happen? Verse 14, and the Word, remember the Word up there in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God. Verse 14 tells you what the Word was, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus, he was God. Yes, he was a man, but he was all God, and he dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. You know, Jesus came. He was the Word. He was from the beginning, but he came to light the way to God to every person who will. So the Gospel of John, if you read all through there about Jesus and the things he did, and every bit of it was done there so that people could see and believe on his name and be saved. If I had to say what the whole Gospel of John, it was put there so people would believe and be saved. But then as we jump over here, and he was the light there in the Gospel of John. He was a light to the whole world. But over here as we jump into the first epistle of John, or 1 John right here, he is the light again. And he starts out very similar. You can tell it was the same person writing, very similar. Chapter 1 here in 1 John, he said, that was which was from the beginning. Again, the beginning. He wants that point across there. Jesus, he didn't just happen there at the beginning of the New Testament. He was from the beginning. He was the beginning. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. Who's that? Jesus. They saw him. They listened to his words. They touched Jesus. He said, for he was the word of life, for the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. You know, God was in the flesh. He was manifested there to these disciples. He goes on, that Jesus, that which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Now listen, pretty much the purpose of this writing right here, he explains who Jesus was and all that he did. He said, and these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. Now John's gospel over there, it was so people could see Jesus and believe and be saved. But I believe the main purpose, obviously the main purpose of 1 John here, is sure that we know that we're saved and all that, but that we live a pleasing life to God. And he tells us how to do this. Here's how we do this. If we've been saved, he said, these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. We want to be joyous, don't we? We want to have peace with God. We want to be where we need to be with God. And that's the only way we're going to get there and have that joy, is if we have our heart right with God. He goes on, he said, this then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. What do we read over there in the Gospel of John? It said he was the light that shines into the world, shines into all the world. He said, here's the message, And here's what we're giving you this message for, is so that your joy may be full. This is the message that we have heard of him and declaring to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. I read that verse several times. I said, if there's any dark areas in my life, if there's any things in my life that I wouldn't want nobody else to know about, or any hidden things that nobody knows about and I would want to keep a secret, that's not of God, is it? That's not of God. That's not pleasing to God. He says, because God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If there's any dark things in my life, like I said, hidden grudges against somebody, jealous or spite, as I was studying about this and thinking about it, it made me, whenever I do things during the day or on the job like there yesterday, I thought, I wonder if I got any reasoning for doing that. It ain't right. Makes you think when you think about not being in darkness, don't it? Because things that's in the dark, things that's secret, things that don't know, nobody knows about, spiteful things, hurtful things, all that kind of stuff, that's dark stuff. That's not of God. That's not of God at all. That's those things in those dark places. He said, in God, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. He goes on, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. Makes me want to examine. Makes me want to pray and ask God to shine the light in there. Go ahead and pull the lid off and look in all the rooms and see what's in there. Shine the light and see. And if there's something not pleasing, and God shines the light on that, I want to do something about that. I want to get rid of that, don't you? Amen. Why would I want to do that? Because he says that's how we're going to have joy. He says that's how our joy is going to be full. And that's what we want, is to be full. We want to be saved. We want to be where we need to be with God, and we want to have that fullness of joy. He goes on, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. Sometimes I'm afraid we can lie to our own self. There's things in our life a lot of times that we just kind of overlook and kind of keep tucked back in the corner. It's not pleasing to God. Oh, that's all right. No, it's not. You know, we need to open these things up and let God shine his light. He says we lie and do not the truth if we walk in darkness and say we have fellowship with him. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. As I'll read on down through here just in a little bit, maybe on into the second chapter here just in a minute, but it's all about living pleasing to God and loving one another. And that's what happens when we let the light shine in. He goes on there, and you might be saying, well, I'm right, just, and that's good. If we're here tonight and everything's just right, that's just a great thing. But we ought to, every once in a while, ask God to shine the light, see what he sees. Make sure there ain't something in there that's not pleasing to God. And that'll work if only if we allow him to turn that light and show us. By the way, God already sees, but he has to show us sometimes things that's not pleasing. I wrote down in my notes, and I believe it'd be a fair thing to say, it'd be a good thing for me a lot of times to slow down and think before I speak. Say, God, shine your light in there and see if what I'm saying, the words that's coming out, is what ought to be, or if that's not right. It'd be a good thing for me a lot of times to slow down and think before I act. Amen. Let God shine the light in there, guide and direct a little bit. Be a good idea for me a lot of times to think before I respond. We've been working up yonder, and the phone service is really, really no good. And there's a guy, I believe he's got pretty good confidence in me, and he wanted me to come look at a job that I ain't got time to do. And he called, and he kept calling, and leaving text messages and calls, and I said, I'm going to call him back and tell him that I ain't got no good phone service and I ain't got time. And I said, that's not the right response. God let the light shine in, amen? And I said, I'm going to wait till I'm relaxed and I'm not. And when I finally did call him, I said, hey, my phone's probably going to drop three times before I get done talking to you. But we need to let the light shine in a lot of times before we speak, before we act, before we respond. Slow down and think. And let the light shine in before we do anything. Amen. We can do that, or we can wish we had of. That's my case a lot of times. I can slow down and wait on God and let God shine the light, or I can wish I did. You know, talk to God. Ask God to examine and show me, lead and guide me in His way, you know, and turn from any bad ways, amen, and any bad motives and thoughts. It ain't just things we do and say and respond. These thoughts run through my head. I don't know about yours a lot of times. But God needs to shine the light and say, and He will, and show us that ain't no good. Where'd that come from? It didn't come from the light. That come from darkness. But He goes on there, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. You know, John is pretty raw, wasn't he? He pretty much put it out right there. I wrote in my head, up here in my margin a long time ago, I said, that's daily humbling words right there. He said, if we say we have no sin, we deceive our own self and the truth's not fooling nobody but our own self if we say we don't have any sin. If we, here's where we can get it right though, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I'm thankful for that. If we confess our sins, not if we hide it, not if we pretend it ain't there, not if we just kind of let it go and all these things, but if we confess that sin, He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. He goes on, you say, jump over in another chapter. Yeah, because it talks about the light here just a little bit more. My little children, these things I write unto you, that ye sin not. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. You know, it would be God's desire and the best for us that we wouldn't sin, but there ain't none of us perfect. And I'm thankful it ain't three strikes and you're out, because we fail a lot of times. Does that give us right to sin? Does that give us a license to sin? No, but when we do sin and we realize that and we bring it to God, we've got an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. You know, I'm thankful when we realize what we've done and realize we've done wrong and come to Him and confess, He'll forgive us. You know, Jesus is sitting there. That's one of mine. He's sitting there. He's like our lawyer. He's like our advocate there. That's one of mine. He's asked forgiveness in the name of Jesus. You know, and God will forgive. But He goes on, and hereby do we know that we know Him if we keep His commandments. And he that saith, I know Him, and keepeth not His commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. He goes on, and again, he's very straightforward there. You know, we say, well, I ain't done this and I ain't done that. You know, we're fooling nobody but our own self. He goes on, but whoso keepeth His word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in Him. He that saith he abideth in Him ought himself also so to walk, even as He walked. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in Him and in you, because the darkness is past and the true light now shineth. You know, when we get saved, it's the old song, you say, I saw the light. That's what happens. You know, God shines His light. He shows us where we're at, shows us His love, shows us that He'll forgive us, He'll save us, shows us that need, then He saves us, and then He shines His light in there. And it don't just stop then. He continues to shine His light and show us how we stand with Him. He that saith he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. You know, he started out right there talking about, you know, we keep His commands. If we don't keep His commands, you know, we're not where we need to be with God. We're not right with God. We're only fooling ourselves. But he goes on, you know, we're not just to keep God's commands, but we're to love one another. Let me read that again. He that saith he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light. Amen? Can anybody say amen that when you get saved and God shines His light in there, and we get saved and born into God's family, and that light, it makes us want to love others, don't it? The love of God in our heart makes us want to love others. And if we hate somebody or have hate and things like that, that's not of light, that's of darkness. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness, and walketh in darkness, and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness hath blinded his eyes. You know, it's light and dark. You know, we can look around. We can look around in the world and say, why is things going this way? Why is this happening? Why does that bunch believe this? Why? Because they're in the dark. That's why it is. We say, boy, that bunch over there, or that bunch that's running our country into the ground, or that bunch that's doing all these things wrong, why do they do that? Because they're in the dark. You know, we've seen the light. We've seen the right way. We've seen the ways of God. We've seen the love of God because the light shined in there. You know, and that's just the difference. It's light and darkness. That's what it's all about. And you know, that here tonight, maybe the message tonight is God's light shining in there and showing us how we stand with Him. Could we draw closer to God? Would we ask God tonight, allow His light to shine in there? Maybe areas we could draw closer to Him. Maybe do more for Him. Maybe get a little bit closer. Maybe whatever the need might be. Something needs removed. Something needs us putting more work on. You know, allow God to shine that light. I don't want anybody's heart here tonight, folks, but His word is pretty plain. God is light, and in Him is no darkness. He shines that light in there, shows us what we stand in need of. I'm going to ask you to stand here tonight. There may be a need, maybe something you need to come and pray about. God showed you something. Maybe God shined the light in there here tonight. Somewhere if there's a way for us to draw closer to Him, well, that'd be the very thing tonight to do is bring it to God. I don't want anybody's heart, but if He spoke to you for any reason, the altar's open at this time. Anybody got a need? Feel like that is sufficient. I hope and pray you've got something out of this word. I thank God for His light. A lot of times it shines things in my life that I maybe didn't want to see or didn't want to admit, but I'm thankful that God shows us those things so we can get where we need to be with Him. Has anybody got something on your heart tonight you'd want to make mention of, something you'd want to say or thank God for? Anybody? Anybody? Amen. Praise the Lord for answering prayers. Anybody else, something you want to thank God for? Well, I appreciate you being here. Good crowd here tonight. Seemed like to me it was a good crowd up on the hill. I don't know how many kids they was, but it seemed like they was a lot. Really a lot of workers. Seemed to me like a lot of new workers up there, and I thank God for each one putting forth time and effort to come and be a part of the Bible Challenge. I think that's one of them things that we do that's going to amount to something. I'm satisfied it is. And I appreciate everyone coming and helping and bringing kids. Anything you want to say or make mention of before we dismiss? Anybody? Nothing else, then I'm going to ask Jason if he'll dismiss us in prayer and just pray for the service come up Sunday morning, and you'll be free to go.